العلم أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدمي. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
الحديث 38 حديث عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم the prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said okay, is the same for a thought. If a bad thought comes to you, do you get rewarded? No, a bad thought you don't, يعني everyone gets bad thoughts, you don't get rewarded necessarily for that. But what you do get rewarded is if you wanted to do a sin and you turned it, you left it for the sake of Allah, not out of inability to do it. He said, "Inna Allah Ta'ala qal." Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala said. So what is hadith quote? It's called hadith ilahi. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, "Man 'ada li waliya faqad adhantuhu bil harb." Whoever has enmity towards a wali of mine.
What is a wali?
A wali is a friend of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, someone who Allah who is kullu mu'minin taqi. Every believer who has taqwa. Every believer who has taqwa is called a wali, like Allah says in the Quran. Ala inna awliya Allah la khawfun alayhim wa lahum yahzanun. The awliya of Allah, there's no fear upon them and they won't be sad. Who are they? Alladhina amanu wa kanu yattaqun. Those who have belief and they have taqwa. These are the awliya of Allah. And a person becomes more of a wali, the more taqwa and the more belief, the more iman he has. And obviously the highest of those are the prophets. And the people who follow the prophets are who? The scholars. So therefore the highest of the awliya after the prophets are the scholars. So whoever has enmity towards the wali, enmity towards the people of knowledge, for example, enmity towards the Muslims, enmity towards the people who worship Allah, فَقَدْ أَذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ. Then I have announced a war against that person. Allah Azza wa Jal has announced a war against a person who has enmity towards the people of al-wilaya, the people of taqwa, the Muslims, the believers, the awliya of Allah, the friends of Allah, from amongst them being the scholars. And this is why we fear for those people who have enmity and they speak bad against the scholars constantly. They speak bad against the scholars of the people of the sunnah. That Allah Azza wa Jal is at war with these people. Then Allah says, how can we get closer to Allah? وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّ افْتَرَضْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ. The slave, he doesn't get closer to Allah with something that is more beloved to Allah than what Allah has obligated upon him. Meaning, the obligations are the best way to get closer to Allah. Your 5 daily prayers, fasting Ramadan, the zakah is better than any other fasting, better than any other charity, is better than any other voluntary salah. These are the best good deeds that you can do. So take care of them more than you take care of any other good deed, the obligatory things. وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ. And the slave, he consistently gets closer to me. بِالنَّوَافِلِ, with the nawafil, the voluntary good deeds. حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ, until I love him. Meaning, so for you to do the obligatory salah, obligatory is something that Allah loves. And a person after the obligatory things, if he constantly does good deeds that are voluntary, praying at night, fasting, extra charity, extra good deeds, what is the result of that? This is how he becomes a wali of Allah. Allah loves him. Then when Allah loves him, and this person becomes a wali of Allah, فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ, when I love him, كُنْتُ سَمْعَهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ, I become the hearing that he hears with. وَبَصَرْ, meaning Allah, I will explain it then. وَبَصَرَهُ, and I become the eyes that الَّذِي يُبْصِرُ بِهِ, that he sees with. And I become وَيَدَهُ الَّتِي يَبْطِشُ بِهَا, I become his hand that he hits with. وَرِجْلَهُ الَّتِي يَمْشِي بِهَا, and I become his feet that he walks with. What does that mean? It doesn't mean literally Allah becomes your hand, Allah becomes your feet, Allah becomes your eyes, Allah becomes your ears. No. It means that you do not hear anything except what Allah loves. You do not see anything except for what Allah loves. You do not use your hand for anything except for what Allah loves. And your feet does not walk to anything except what Allah loves. When my Shaykh Salih al-Usaymi was explaining this, he told us a story of a man who he met. He said to him that he has never seen a TV in his life. Not out of poverty. Living in Saudi Arabia. He's never seen a TV in his life. And that's shocking to some people. when you understand it, and he said that person can you Sunday used to pray every night 4 hours. Salih Usaymi told us that. So he's never seen a TV in his life. And that is the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his eyes, right? And then he says, Wala in sa'alani la'i'tiyanna. If this person, now the slave who I love, if he asks me, I will definitely give to him. La'i'tiyanna, I will definitely give to him. Noon is tawkeed, emphasis. Wala in ista'adhani, and if he seeks refuge with me, la'u'idhanna, I would definitely protect him. Right? And so this is from the great virtues of the people who are the people of taqwa. This is from the virtues of having love from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is how to gain the love of Allah. Is that you make sure that you look after your obligatory deeds and you make sure that you do the voluntary deeds as well. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إن الله تجاوز لي عن أمتي الخطأ والنسيان وما استكره عليه حديث حسن رواه ابن ماجه والبيهقي وغيرهما. This hadith, even though it's a chain of narration, might be slightly weak, but it is a hadith that is a principle in Islam, and it's a principle that is agreed upon amongst all of the Muslims, amongst the scholars. And that is that Allah, in Allah, has forgiven, He forgives my ummah, al-khata', a mistake, al-khata'. What is al-khata'? Al-khata' is for a person to do something without having intended that action. So, for example, he threw a rock. He was trying to throw a rock to catch an animal. And once it hits a human being, it kills him. That's a khata', it's a mistake. Allah forgives that. That is forgiven. That is the person not sinful in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But obviously, he still has to pay blood money because he took the right of a Muslim. But he, in front of Allah, he's not sinful. Wal nisyan, and Allah forgives my ummah for any mistake. What is nisyan? Forgetfulness. Anything that you forget, Allah is also forgiven that as well. So that's the second thing. Some people, they constantly ask, what if I do it by accident? What if I forget? Remember this principle. Allah has forgiven. In terms of sin with Allah, if you forget something, then Allah has forgiven it. وَمَا اسْتُكْرِهُ عَلَيْهِ, and whatever they are, or الْاِسْتِكْرَهُ, whatever you are forced to do, Allah has forgiven that as well. Person comes to you and he says to you, eat this pork, otherwise I'm going to kill you. That person's allowed. Break your fast, otherwise I'm going to kill you. That person's allowed. But the ikrah has to be ikrah. The fuqaha, they mentioned, it has to be ikrah mulji. It is an actual, يعني, a person who's able to fulfill his threat. يعني, if a baby comes to you and he says to you, you know, do this or I'm going to kill you, of course the baby can't do anything. That's not considered to be ikrah. Al-ikrah is someone who can actually fulfill his threat. طيب. And this is a principle that is known in Islam. ربنا الرحمن كما قال
السيد. والخطا والاكراه والنسيان اسقطه معبود الرحمن.
الله اكبر. والخطا
والاكراه والنسيان اسقطه معبود الرحمن.
معبود الرحمن. That is a principle from the قواعد الفقهيه, and it's based on this hadith. Those things are forgiven. طيب. وعن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما, from ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما, he narrates, قال اخذني رسول اخذ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بمنكبي. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he grabbed my shoulder and he said to me, "Kun fi dunya ka'annaka gharib aw 'abiru sabil." Be in this dunya as if you are a stranger or you're a person who is crossing a road. Yani, I'll be going to be in one of two states, and one of them is better than the other. In this dunya, we know we're not going to be here forever. The akhirah is waiting for us, right? And this is not our houses. Allah, as Allah says in the Quran, and it's not our real lives. As Allah says in the Quran, وَإِنَّ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ. The dar of the akhirah, it is the real life. The dar of the akhirah, the house of the akhirah, that is the real life. So because of that, we were commanded not to make this dunya as if we're going to be here forever. So we are commanded to be in the dunya as if we are غُرَبَاء غَرِيب, a stranger. What is a stranger? A stranger is someone who comes to a land that he is not resident of. يعني مثلا, a person from London, you go to Birmingham, you go to Manchester, you go to Leicester, you go to a local city, that's not your land. You're going there, you're visiting, and you're coming back. That is how your expected to be in this dunya. That is the minimal level. Be like that at least. Realize that I'm here for a temporary amount of time. So I'm not going to now come and decorate. Do you ever go to a hotel and decorate your hotel, buy new furniture for your hotel room? You never do that, right? So that is how it's supposed to be in this dunya. That's the minimum. And even better, how can you be even better? Oh, abiru sabil, make this dunya as if you're just crossing a road. When you're crossing a road, do you stop? You don't even stop. You literally cross the road and just walk from one side of the road to the other side. That's how you're meant to be in this dunya. Take this dunya as a pathway to the akhirah. And you on that pathway, what are you doing? You're worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gaining that zad, that provision that you need for the akhirah. So we've been commanded to be on one of these two stages. And it is better to be on the higher stage. That's why Abiru Sabeel, to be as if you're crossing a path. That's why Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, كان يقول, he used to say, إِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ, if you see yourself in the evening, فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الصَّبَاحِ, do not wait for the morning. Do not expect that you're going to live in the morning. Expect that you're going to die tonight. And worship Allah the way you would die. In a way that you're thinking as if you would have died tomorrow. If you're going to die tomorrow, how would I worship Allah? Worship Allah like you would do that. وَإِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ, when you wake up, فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الْمَسَاءِ, do not wait for the evening. Because death, it comes to you suddenly. Right? So be someone who is not connected to this dunya. They are constantly reminding themselves of death. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَكْثِرُ مِنْ ذِكْرِ هَادِ مِنْ لَذَّاتِ. Constantly remind yourself of the destroyer of the pleasures. That's death. Because why is it called destroyer of the pleasures? Because it destroys that pleasure of this dunya that you have. You might enjoy this dunya for a bit, but then you remember death, and it completely destroys that pleasure that you had in this dunya, and it reminds you that your actual life is in the akhirah. Why am I enjoying this dunya like that? As if I'm going to be in here forever. Right? So we're commanded to be people who are people of zuhud. We don't take too much of this dunya. We don't look at it. We don't expect too much of this dunya. We remind ourselves constantly that we're going to die, and the akhirah is our real lives. And so act like that when it comes to the way you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? And as some of the hadith narrate, وَصَلُّوا صَلَاتَ مُوَدِّعَ, pray the way of a person is praying when he's about to die. This is good, as if you're going to be last prayer. Pray every prayer as if it is your last prayer. And it is not sunnah for a person to say that before the salah, when say استو and say صَلُّوا صَلَاتَ مُوَدِّعَ, that's not sunnah. لَكِنْ عَلَيْهِ حَالِ, it is something that we should do. Remind ourselves that we will pray like that. وَخُذْ مِنْ صِحَّتِكَ لِمَرَضِكَ, and take from your health for your illness. يعني, when you're healthy, take advantage of that time. Because you're going to be in a state one day where you're not healthy, you're not able to do what you used to do when you're healthy. And if you did take advantage of your health, then when you are ill, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will write for you that those same good deeds that you used to do when you were healthy. Right? Just like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever becomes ill or he travels, he gets rewarded the same rewards that he used to do when he was healthy and he was muqeem, he was resident. So a person, when he's ill, when he's healthy, sorry, he's doing good deeds, then even when he becomes ill, he'll be getting that same reward as well. So take advantage of that. وَمِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ, and from your life, take from your life in preparation for your death. Then he says, الحديث الحادي والأربعون, the 41st hadith, عن أبي محمد عبد الله بن عمرو بن العاص, عبد الله بن عمرو بن العاص رضي الله عنهما قال, he said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يكون هواه تبعا لما جئت به, حديث حسن رويناه في كتاب الحجة بإسناد صحيح. This hadith is narrated by كتاب الحجة, يعني الحجة في بيان المحجة لإبراهيم المقدسي, right? أو الحجة على تارك المحجة, sorry, الحجة على تارك المحجة لأبي الفتح نصر بن إبراهيم المقدسي. He narrates this hadith, and الشيخ صالح عسيمي narrates, says that it is a weak hadith, والله أعلم. And then he says the hadith is, but the meaning is correct. He says, none of you will truly believe until his desires, they follow what I came with. And this is two types. Meaning your desires must be in conforming towards what the Prophet ﷺ came with. يعني, and there's two types. Number one, it is the thing that the Prophet ﷺ came with that is the foundation of our religion, at-tawheed. If your desires do not conform with tawheed, then you don't believe at all. Your Islam is null and void. And second, the second desires that you need to have, that you should be conforming with the religion of Islam, is the conforming with the things that are the sub-branches of Islam. Right? So يعني, this hadith, it is talking about the negation of not the foundation of iman, but rather your perfection of iman. A person, his good, his desires, they are with conforming with what Allah wants. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Do this." He not only does he do it, but he wants to do it. It becomes part of his desires. This is part of the perfection of the iman of a slave, that he really loves to do what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him to do. He loves to do what Allah Azza wa Jal told us to do, right? So this is the perfection of iman. As for if it is hard for them, and their desires are not there yet, then it doesn't mean they're a kafir unless it's to do with tawheed. He doesn't want to worship Allah alone. He wants to worship something else. This now negates a person's Islam. Lakin, what he's talking about generally is from people, when they it's hard for them to pray. And that person, no doubt, the iman is naqis. So they need to get it up. The iman is deficient. They need to get it up, right? And this is the way of the believer. The way of the true believer is that he follows what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do. And this is sahaba, well, the best example of that. The sahaba, not only did they follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the ibadah, in act of worship. That's why sometimes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wouldn't do an act of worship just because the sahaba, they would do it and he would be scared that they'll think it's obligatory. And he'll be scared that Allah will make it obligatory upon them because of how eager the sahaba they were to do certain things. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to fast during the day and night. He wouldn't break his fast at night. He literally wouldn't break his fast for days and ends. 2 days, 3 days, he'll be fasting. And he, because the sahaba, they were the highest level of imtithal, of following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had to forbid them from doing that same fast. And today, the people, what they say, it's only sunnah. It's only sunnah. قارن بين يعني just look at the difference between us and the Sahaba, but then you realize it when you remember the call of Abdullah ibn Mubarak رحمه الله تعالى, when he says لا تأتينا بذكرنا مع ذكرهم ليس الصحيح إذا مشى كالمقعدي. Don't mention us with those people, because the one who is healthy, he's not the same as the one who's paralyzed. Just like that, we're not the same as the Sahaba, subhanAllah. They were a different level. Look at the generation that we're living in today, where a person, they won't do something because it's sunnah. When the sahaba, they would fight to do something because it's sunnah. Not only that, when, imagine, look at this. How a person, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he would eat with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he'd say the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يَتَتَبَّعُ الدُّبَّاءَ فِي الصَّحِحِ. He would follow and he would eat the pumpkins that are in the plate. And so he said, so from that day, I always loved a dubba, I always loved pumpkin. He loved pumpkin because the Prophet used to love it. We're not even talking about ibadah here, we're talking about food. Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, ni'ma al-idamu khal. He says, what a beautiful kind of like sauce vinegar is. He said, we don't have anything in the house except for vinegar. So he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praised vinegar. He said, from that day, I love vinegar. And he loves the food that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam loved. Fatima radiallahu anha used to walk the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to walk. Right? They would know these things about him. But this is the true iman. As we say, la yumna ahadukum, you never believe until your desires, they follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from amongst them. The last hadith, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu qala, sami'tu Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam yaqul, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, قال الله تعالى الله عز وجل he says يا ابن آدم أو son of Adam إنك دعوتني ورجوتني غفرت لك على ما كان منك ولا أبالي. أو son of Adam, if you, as long as you'd make dua to me, you call upon me and you hope in me, you have hope that I'm going to forgive you, غفرت لك, I will forgive you, على ما كان منك ولا أبالي, no matter what you done. This gives hope in the slave. No matter what you've done. as long as you make dua to me and you hope that I forgive you, I will forgive you no matter what you've done. Ya ibn Adam, O son of Adam, لو بلغت ذنوبك عنان السماء, if your sins they reached the top, the skies, your sins they reach all the way up to the sky. ثم استغفرتني, then you ask me to forgive you. غفرت لك, I will forgive you. يا ابن آدم, O son of Adam, إنك لو أتيتني, if you came to me, بقراب الأرض خطايا, with the earth full of sins. قراب يعني ملء. The قراب, the earth full of sins. ثم لقيتني, then you met me, you came to me on the day of judgment. لا تشرك بي شيئا, and you never used to do shirk. You are upon tawheed. لأتيتك بقرابها مغفرة. I will come to you with the whole earth full of forgiveness. And this shows the fadl of Allah Azza wa Jal. As he mentioned in another hadith, إِنَّ رَحْمَتِي سَبَقَتْ غَضَبِي, my mercy, it overcomes my anger. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us. Allah Azza wa Jal, he forgives all sins as long as the person doesn't die on shirk. Person who dies upon shirk, that person will not be forgiven. As for a person, he done shirk, and he repented from shirk before he died, then Allah will forgive that person as well. Right? And Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ, say, O my slaves who have transgressed against themselves, لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ, do not ever feel despair in the mercy of Allah. Do not ever feel like you're never ever going to get or lose hope in the mercy of Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا, no doubt Allah forgives all sins. So ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you, and Allah will forgive every sin that person done. And from the lessons that we gain from this hadith, by the way, is that a person, for him to lose hope, say Allah will never forgive me, that is a major sin. That is a bigger sin than the sin that you actually done. That is a bigger sin than the sin that you actually done. A Muslim, we are always hopeful in the mercy of Allah. But we are not also, we don't become now complacent when it comes to doing sins. So a person says, Ya Allah will forgive all sins, so I'll do all sins and I ask Allah to forgive me. Who told you you're going to live until the time that you're able to ask Allah to forgive you? Right? So we need to be between hope and fear. Fear from the sins, but we also need to have hope in Allah. But it's not ever allowed for a person to be someone who loses hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَا إِنَّهُ لَا يَأْسُ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. There's no one who loses hope in the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after hardship, except for the disbelievers. And Allah says another verse in the Quran, إِنَّهُ وَمَنْ يَقْنَطُ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ رَبِّي إِلَّا الضَّالُّونَ. Who loses hope in the mercy of Allah, in His Lord, except for the misguided people. But the other side also, Allah says about the other side of the people, the opposite is, فَأَمِنُوا مَكْرَ اللَّهِ, do they feel safe from the punishment of Allah? فَلَا يَأْمَنُوا مَكْرَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. No one, he feels safe from the punishment of Allah except for people who are losers. So we are constantly, we should be between the two. We should be between fear and hope. Hope in the mercy of Allah. Know that Allah can forgive all sins, but also be fearful of our sins and ask Allah to forgive us for them. الخاتمة الكتاب الشيخ أبو زكريا يحيى بن شرف النووي الإمام, he mentions as a the end of the book, he says, concludes the book by, he says, فهذا آخر ما قصدته من بيان الأحاديث, this is the last thing that I intended when it comes to mentioning these أحاديث, التي جمعت قواعد الإسلام, these أحاديث that combined all of the principles of Islam, وتضمنت ما لا يحصي من أنواع العلوم, and it has so much, has innumerable amount of knowledge, في الأصول والفروع, when it comes to the foundations of our religion and the sub-branches of our religion, والآداب and mannerisms, وسائري وجوه الأحكام, and all other types of rulings. وها أنا أذكر بابا مختصرا في ضبط خفي ألفاظها مرتبا لئلا يغلط في شيء منها ويستغني بها حافظها عن مراجعة غيره في ضبطها. Then he mentioned that he's going to mention a page which we're not going to go through, where he mentioned some of the words which are not really often used, but obviously we translated it to English, so it's okay, we don't need to go through that. ثم أشرع في شرحها إن شاء الله, then he explains it. في كتاب مستقل. So the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he promised to explain this book Al-Arba'in al-Nawawi, but what is clear is that he never explained Al-Arba'in al-Nawawi because he died. He died at a young age of 45. فأرجو من فضل الله تعالى أن يوفقني فيه لبيان مهمات من اللطائف. So he asked Allah to make it easy for him to mention benefits from this to, in explanation. وجمل من الفوائد والمعارف and benefits and knowledge. لا يستغني مسلم عن معرفة مثلها ويظهر لمطالعها جزالة هذه الأحاديث وعظم فضلها وما اشتملت عليه من النفائس التي ذكرتها والمهمات التي وصفتها ويعلم الحكمة باختيار هذه الأحاديث الأربعين وأنها حقيقة بذلك عند الناظرين. I just want to explain the hadith, but he never got to do so. وإنما أفردتها عن هذا الجزء ليسهل حفظ الجزء بانفراده. And so he mentioned that he wrote this book to make it easy. He didn't explain it here. He's going to explain it somewhere else. من أراد ضم الشرح إليه فليفعل والله عليه المنة بذلك إذ يقف على نفائس اللطائف من كلام الله من قال الله في حقه وما ينطق عن الهوى إن هو إلا وحي يوحى ولله الحمد أولا وآخرا وباطنا وظاهرا. And he ends it with that. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.